Hello friends, so first I introduce myself. I am Saket Persu. I run a company named Eisenfish Consultancy Private Limited and I train people on project management. Like, say project management, I train them on PMP based certification program, general project management. I also train people on agile based projects. I am PMIECP and PMP certification trainer. I am also a certified Scrum professional, and we as an organization, we are registered education provider of PMI, and we are also registered education provider of Scrum Alliance. Now, in today's session, I am introducing two, three things. I am introducing project and project management. I will talk about what is this PMDoc is all about, and then at the end, we will talk about a PMP certification. Now, during this presentation, whenever you get a query, you keep typing in the chat box. I will take that during Q&A breaks. So you don't have to wait for Q&A till the end. I have two intermediate Q&A breaks, which are primarily focusing on the segment which I finish. And once we are done with these two Q&A breaks, we will have a final one, which is at the end of the session. So the agenda for this session is project management, PMDoc guide, and a PMP certification. Now, what is project? Now, we are thinking of doing PMP certification, or we are thinking of making a career in project management. It's good to define project before we get into the certification or a PMDoc. Now, you might have seen various definitions of a project. But the PMDoc guide 5th edition defines project as a temporary endeavor undertaken to create a unique product, service or result. Now found this definition may look confusing. In simple term, you can think of that this is a temporary intense activities which you are doing for a defined duration, for a planned defined duration. At the end of these activities, you try to achieve a goal. You try to have that, okay, this is done and this project is over. After that, team get dispersed, people go their home or get allocated to the next project or they will return to their department. So that is how the project is. Now, it produces something which can be consumed at a later point of time. So it end up delivering a product. Sometimes a given product may not produce the end product output, but it may contribute some other project in delivering the end product. So you may also end up delivering a component as output of the project. Now, for example, you want to set up a branch of a fast food restaurant. So you want to set up a service so people can be served the fast food. Now, setting up such kind of service will also require a temporary focused activity. Once it is done, it can be continued going forward. So that will also fall under the category of project, because a project may also result in establishing a service which is for a capability to perform a service. Now, there could be a case where project does not produce any product or any service, but it may end up producing a document. Yeah. Say for example, the government of India wants to know that, okay, what are the reasons of the polio? So they have created a team which is doing the study and recommending that these are the root causes of polio. So a project may end up producing an end report which help subsequent project or subsequent decision are made. Now, in order to understand the project, it is advisable to understand the difference between project and operations. Now, operations are ongoing, like they are not temporary. So what does it mean? If I am working as a cashier in a bank, I keep visiting the same bank and I will keep supporting the cash counter. I don't have any end date in my mind. I may do have my own appraisal plan, but there will be always a cashier who will be giving money in a bank. It's an ongoing operation. Where in a project, everything is temporary. You are doing scoping, you are doing analysis and design, you will deliver an output, and after that you will disappear. The new team will take care of a future delivery. So projects are temporary. Operations are ongoing. They don't have a defined end date. Now, in order to manage a temporary project, you need to work with a management style which is called project management. When you are managing operations, you need to work with an operational management or a business process management. See, when you are doing a operational management, your focus is managing efficiencies, qualities, ensuring that the operation can produce repetitive things at a predictable service level agreement. While managing project, your focus is that you are delivering project, whatever uncertain goal which you have defined for yourself, you are trying to meet that uncertain environment and trying to create the output for which the project has been undertaken. So it produces a unique product or output or a service or a report, while an operation produces the same thing repetitively. So once you have set it up the fast food restaurant, the fast food restaurant is producing burgers repetitively. So it's still a product, but it's more unique. You know, whenever you order a burger, you get the same burger. It's an operation. So an operation produces the same product continuously, repetitively, while as project produces a unique product once. So if you look at this picture, now this is an activity you are doing to extract oil from the ground. Now when you are doing this activity, at the first time you are doing, say, soil testing, you are projecting that, okay, this ground is, there is a high probability of getting oil, and then you are investing money, the organization is investing money to extract oil from that particular area. So when you are doing this first time, it's a project, because you are setting up the oil well or whatever name you want to give it. But once it is done, going forward, you need to run it on a continuous basis. When you are running it on a continuous basis, it becomes operation. So there is a defined activity. At a particular time, it starts, you extract oil, it goes to the refinery, etc., etc. There is a plant in charge, there are engineers, and they are there forever. So usually, the projects get converted into an operations after they set up the base. Similar example, this is a factory which produces laptops, for example. Now, initially, when you were setting up that particular factory, it was a project because you are doing location analysis, you are identifying that where should, how the layout should be made, how the line should be designed, you are doing test runs, and once that is done, it is an operation. People are working day in, day out. Once you are in operation, it does not mean that it becomes very fixed. You do have a continuous improvement in your operations also. That continuous improvement is based on a predictable data. See, it's not like that you have designed one line and that line will remain forever. You may have another project which may help us in redesigning the line so there could be a better output, or we can reduce the cycle time. Now, what makes the project special? Now, you may think that, okay, management is management, and be it operation, be it project, you always have limited resources, limited time. Now, what makes the project so special? Prime factor in project management is good amount of uncertainties. The operations are well predictable. You do have a baseline data because you have been doing it for years, 6 months, 7 months, 12 months. In this project, you are getting into unseen territory. So for example, if you are launching a mission to a moon, which is a spacecraft, you have never been there. You will design, you will have a lot of uncertainties, there will be a lot of risks, and you still have a plan. You think that in the next 1 hour, 2 hour, or 10 days, you will be covering this much distance, but those plans keep changing very frequently because many risks, many uncertainties, which could not be visualized, keeps coming. So in project, things remain more uncertain than operations. The skills like risk management becomes more important. The estimations are not certain. You have a higher estimation errors. Whatever timeline dependency you project, you always have a risk of not meeting it. And that is why it needs a special treatment. You can't just apply the management techniques which we use for operational management. Now, you may think, okay, this looks project and all, so why do we do it? why do we need a project? Why can't we just shipping burgers? If I am a restaurant and I can just selling burger, why do I need a project? First thing, initially you need a project, that is because the tag only will set up this restaurant. So if you get into a new business, if you think that I am a pizza restaurant, I want to start a burger restaurant, it's a new business. And start setting up a new business because you have never done it before will require a project. So in order to expand, or you may need a project. A lot of time, in order to sustain, also you need a project. You started selling pizza, now there were no, during that time there was nobody who was selling pizza nearby, but now there are many people, there are many restaurants which has just come up, and they all are selling pizzas. Now in order to differentiate yourself, you need something new. So environment is forcing you to evolve, and that needs a new project. Sometimes government regulation may force you to start a project. For example, you are producing a car, it was complying to a Euro XXX standard or YY standards. Now government has made a regulation that going forward the car can only be sold if it complies with XYZ compliances. Now in order to sell the car further, you need to have a compliant product. So you end up starting a project. Sometimes again the environment, for example technological. I have been using, say, Windows XXX version, and going forward I know that this XXX version is no more supported, or it's difficult to find resources, servers for that particular version. I need to start a project to migrate it to the latest version. So there could be various triggers which can force us to move and start a project. Now, this is a very frequently asked question which I keep getting from my people, from my clients, that it is nothing to do with PMP exam. Even after that, when they are looking for the job or when they are thinking about their career, they keep asking, okay, if I'm a project manager, I can work anywhere. Like if I can make, especially if I can make an oil well, do you think that I can also manage a space project? Or if I can make a plant, I can also make a historical monument, or I can also manage the oil well. Now, a PMI talks about that when you manage a project, you need two types of skills. One, the project management skills, which are more or less equally applicable for all the areas. The another type of skills which you may need are the domain skills. But domain skills can be acquired. For example, the domain-specific skills which are related to oil, which are related to construction industry or a spacecraft would be different. But as per PMDOT is concerned, they don't teach that. They only teach the project management related processes. So for them, they will teach a project management which can be applied, which can be applied in all the environments. Second thing you should remember is the amount of uncertainty also varies from project to project. So there is no one prescribed project management lifecycle. As per your domain, as per the situation, as per the uncertainty expected in that particular domain, you need to identify your project management lifecycle. What I am talking about. Say for example, if things are so dynamic, you can't make a long plan for 1 year, 2 years, because you are changing continuously, say a space mission. But if things are quite stable, say a construction industry, so you know that, okay, this is how the design will be, this is how the layouting will be, this is how the concrete composition will be, many things are quite predefined. So when things are predefined, you can follow a life cycle, which is a kind of a predictive life cycle. When things are not that well predefined, you may need to follow a life cycle, which is an adaptive life cycle. So project is not always project. It also has a domain element. It also has a life cycle related element. But when we study a project management certification, we only study a part of project management, which is unique, which is common in all the projects. Now we are at our first Q&A break. If you limit your questions related to the content which I have covered, PMP related queries, etc., we will take care. We do have a time. We are doing good, I guess, as per our timelines. So in case if you have any query related to the area which I have covered, please raise them and then you move forward. If you don't have any, it's good, no problem, you can take it after the next thing. So what are the domain skills, the first query which has skill? For example, I know oil and gas well, that's a domain skill. I know the space industry well, that's a domain skill. I know project management well, it is not a domain skill. Like project management means I can create a schedule, I can manage risks, I can make a critical path diagram, I can calculate earn values, I can make variance reports. Not much domain skill is there, it's a project management. But can you think that which design would be good for this particular oil well? If you know that, that's a domain skill. So, in order to become a good project manager, you first need to have a project management skills, but in order to write a good niche, you also need to have a domain area expertise in which you are working in. But as far as PMBOK or PMP is concerned, we don't talk about domain skill. Yeah, so technical skills, if you are in a software industry, your domain skill would be that how well you know the technology, how well you know the estimation, how well you know the software specific project management area. Do you understand how the performance testing is done? Do you know how the mobile apps has to be developed or the cloud apps has to be developed? These all are domain skills. Okay, so I move forward. Again, we will have a second Q&A break. You can keep typing your things and I will take them consolidated one. The second Q&A break is coming after this. Okay, so let's move and let's talk about what is project management. So I have already introduced a good amount of project management to you, but if I say it again, as the definition of project management, it's an application of knowledge, skills, tools and techniques to project related activities. So project achieve is goal. So project achieve is requirement. Now, in order to achieve the project goals, you take a subset of general management things, various tools, and you apply them in your project, that is the project management. Now, what this project manager is all about. So I can make a fair assumption that many of you who are attending this session are thinking of playing a role of a project manager, or they are already playing a role of project manager. Some are designated project managers, some are just playing the role. Now, what are the expectations for the project manager? We expect a project manager to be a final CEO of the project. So we in general, he should be the final person who leads the team and who is primarily focused towards making team aware about the project objectives and guiding them in achieving project objectives. So, project manager should not be just a person who creates report or who take estimates from various people and compile them and present it to the management. Now, you may see the project manager doing this thing, but those things are coming as a part of his goal of managing project. They should not become a goal in itself. So the role of a project manager is that he is leading, directing, managing teams, and he is responsible for achieving the project objectives. Now, you might have heard that there is a book called PMBOK. So in subsequent slides, I will be introducing a PMBOK to all of you. Now, PMBOK is a book, is a guide which has a subset of general management knowledge which are primarily focused towards project management. Now, the PMBOK does not claim that it covers everything that is needed to manage the project. No. It is compilation of good practices which generally works in most of the projects, and they are good enough to make one project successful. The goal of a project, the PMBOK, is that we define a common lexicon, a common vocabulary for a project management professional. So when I am saying that your schedule variance is 10%, everybody should understand this. Why? Because we are using the language of a project management. So PMBOK has a goal of creating that language. Now, at a top level, PMBOK covers topics related to project life cycle. Now, Now, project management processes. The projects are divided into various project management processes, project management process groups, various groups, and then project management knowledge areas. So PMBOK can be understood primarily as a collection of processes, and they are given in the form of a knowledge area as well. I'll just explain. So project life cycle, as I said, the space mission project is different from construction project. So PMBOK introduces that there are possible three life cycles. One is predictive life cycle, when things are predictable. Another is an iterative life cycle, where things are not that predictable. You need to iterate. You need to work something on one area, and then you need to iterate again and move next. The adaptive life cycle, where the continuous adaption is needed. That's the third type of life cycle it is recommended. Now, the process, the PMBOK is a collection of 47 processes. So they introduce the content in a way that everything is a process. So processes which has a defined inputs, it has some tools and techniques, and it produces an output. Now it may look confusing. Let's take an example. For example, you need to create a requirement document. You need to collect the requirement from the stakeholders in order to make the software, in order to make design a new product. Now, in order to design that new product, this particular process of collecting requirement is called collect requirement in PMBOK. So collect requirement becomes a process. It will have an input. For example, the contract which you have received from the customer, the list of stakeholders who are relevant for it, the template which should be used while preparing a requirement document, your organization rules that requirement document has to go through 10 levels of approvals. These all becomes an input to this particular process. Now, while doing requirement analysis or collecting requirement, you may follow phenomenal thinking, brainstorming, conduct interviews. They all become tools and techniques. And at the end, you may produce a requirement document that becomes an output. So in this way, the PMBOK is a collection of 47 processes, and these processes covers the project management related work for a given project. These 47 processes are grouped under 5 process groups. Or you can think like that, okay, these all 5 or 47 processes can be categorized in 5 categories or 5 process groups. Now, how the processes which are needed at the initial stages of the phase are called initiating processes, like identifying who are the people relevant for this particular project. So they become an initiating process group processes. Now, a good amount of processes will fall under planning process. For example, you are identifying the list of activities which one should be working on, you are creating a scope document, etc., etc. They all fall under planning processes. After planning is done, you are working. You are producing deliverables, you are guiding teams, motivating teams, managing teams. They all fall under executing. So there are processes under executing process group. Now, a monitoring and control process group primarily focuses on looking at the variance. So I see that Sonam asking, what is the schedule variance? So a monitoring and control process group process would be looking at, this was the plan, this is the reality, execution, what is the variance? So one type of variance which measures the expected timelines against the actual timelines or observed timelines is a schedule variance, because schedule is all about time. So the monitoring and controlling process group takes care of such kind of variance analysis. And at the end, we have a closing project, closing related process groups, like closing of a procurement, closing of the projects. Now, it does not mean that these 5 processes will be executed in a serial in a one critical project. They are iterative in nature. Means, you will be executing, initiating and closing for each and every phase. Like, I am starting a design phase, I am closing a requirement phase, so I will do a closing of a requirement phase, and then I will do an initiating of a design phase. So this is a very brief idea I'm giving. In summary, you can understand that, okay, we have 47 processes and they are grouped under these kind of 5 dimensions. Now another dimension. So ultimately you still have a 47 processes only. One dimension of these 47 processes is the grouping. Like, is it a starting thing? Is it an ending thing? Is it a planning thing? Is it a monitoring and control thing? So it becomes a process group. This is another dimension of the 47 processes is called knowledge area. Is this process related to requirement or a scope? Is this process related to preparing a schedule or managing time? They become knowledge area. So in a scope management, you have a process like collecting requirement, validating requirement, creating a scope statement, etc., etc. They all fall under one knowledge area. So PMBOK has a chapter knowledge area wise, and they explain one chapter and all the processes which are following in that particular knowledge area. You can also think knowledge area as a specialization thing, like you do a finance specialization, you do human resources specialization, they are knowledge area. So everything which is related to human resource will be taught under human resource management knowledge area. Whatever is related to the cost will be taught under cost management knowledge areas. So the processes, the framework is a collection of 47 processes. Processes has two dimensions. One is the time nature, like when they should get performed, initial stage, planning stage, monitoring stage, closing stage. And what is the nature of that particular process? Is this process related to human resource? Is this process related to cost management, etc., etc.? So that is how the knowledge area comes into the picture. So as I said, we have 10 knowledge areas. The first knowledge area is project integration management, which focuses on integrating the remaining 9 knowledge areas. So project scope management is focusing on collecting requirement, making the scope statement, and after that ensuring that the team is working on the right requirement and customer is accepting the product as per the scope. So that's the scope management knowledge area. It has processes related to that. Project time management is all about creating a project schedule. If you have a list of activities, you would be estimating activity duration, you would be estimating activity resources, and then you would be doing critical path analysis and preparing a schedule. And after preparing the schedule, you would be monitoring the schedule that are you going as per the planned timelines. Those kind of processes falls under time management. So project integration management is just ensuring that remaining 9 knowledge area link with each other. I will come back to again. Project cost management is all about managing money. Okay, if this activity is happening, how much will it cost? Project cost management. Project quality management, ensuring the quality policies, quality guidelines are applied while executing project. So that's the knowledge area. Project human resource management, about getting people, training them, motivating them, appraising them, building the team. Human resource management knowledge area. Communication, identifying when should I send a report, which format I should use, should I have a meeting at a weekly level or a monthly level, who needs what. Communication management. Risk management, what can go wrong, what are the uncertainties, making a risk register, evaluating it on a frequent basis, project risk management. Procurement management is about getting help. Do I need to outsource something outside? Okay, if I am outsourcing something outside, then how to make a contract, what type of contract there should be, how should I negotiate, monitor the vendor, etc., etc., falls under procurement management. Project stakeholder management is, I have group of community, group of people who are interested in this project. How do I engage them? How do I positively involve them so they all remain committed towards the project? Now, all looks clear. The integration management may look confusing. Now, integration management has a responsibility of integrating all the remaining 9. For example, if you have made some change in a scope statement, make sure that you also create a scheduled activity under time management. You also estimate cost for it. If there is a risk, then you also do a risk management or identification for it. So quality integration management is a knowledge area which kind of linking the remaining 9 things. So it's like consolidating everything, making sure that time and cost are in always the same. It should not happen that you have scheduled 3 activities and while doing costing you are only calculating 3. So this is how it is. Now I see many questions coming directly towards the TNT exam. So in case you have non-TNT exam related query, please post it, because TNT related exam, TNT exam related query I will take just after the final segment, because I am just going to talk about TNT now. So I think I should move forward. I don't see many queries coming in. So someone is asking that in which management area all inventory comes. So the first thing Sonam, we need to understand is that it is not a production, it is not an operation. So we don't have a very specialized inventory management knowledge area where you talk about minimum ordering quality, quantity, inventory level identification, maintaining all. No, it is uncertain thing. So we don't have those kind of knowledge area related elements. But it will be, if you need to maintain some level of lead time, if you need to maintain some minimum level of inventory, etc., etc., you need to just put it in a schedule, you should put it into your time plan and you should cost it about it. But there is no area which triggers an order because as an inventory goes down, such kind of things or skills are primarily used in production environment rather than a project. But in some project it may become relevant, but they are not so generic or common. Okay, so let's move forward and let's look at the PNP related thing and we take the queries related to PNP. So basic things, PNP certification is a certificate from PMI. PMI is a Project Management Institute, it's a not-for-profit body registered in office in Philadelphia, US, so that is the statistics of it. We have more than 500,000 PNP certified people all over the world, near to 100,000 people all over the world. In India, we have nearby 35,000 PNP certified professionals. So, that's a certification program and it has an eligibility credit. So, who should do PNP? Ideally, people who want to work in projects, who want to live their future career in projects, should do PNP. The minimum quality, the criteria of a project management certification is that you should be already working as a project manager. Not necessary as a designated project manager, maybe a coordinator, maybe associate project manager, but you should be already involved in a project management related activities. So that's an expectation from a person who is doing PNP certification. So it has an eligibility criteria which is primarily focused on experience. If you are having 4-year degree, then you should be having 3 years of leading and managing a project experience. If you are having secondary degree, you are college dropout, then you need a 5 years of leading and directing project experience. Now this experience should be acquired in the last 8 years. It should not be like that I have been working 15 years, 10 years ago I did this project. That is not applicable. The last 8 years are applicable, but again having said that, I can keep getting query, I am not working for last 3 years, 2 years, but before that I have worked on the project. Am I eligible? You are. Because if the experience will be only counted for last 8 years. Now, what is leading and directing? So I spoke about 5 processes, like you are making schedule, I spoke about those knowledge area. So whatever I have spoken, if you find that, okay, these are the sum of the activities we do while we do the work, those kind of activities are required when you make your project experience. Now, how the project, so the related question, so I'm just, since I'm on the slide, I'm taking it. How the PMI verifies it? PMI works on a trust basis system. In some percentage, they do a random audit. So, if your application gets selected for the audit, they will ask some documentation proof to justify your experience. What is that documentation proof? As far as experience is concerned, when you declare your experience, you need to tell the name of the person who was working with you as a manager or as a primary stakeholder. You need to fill the that person details. So if you get selected for the audit, that person needs to sign on the paper which you have prepared. So that is how that PMI verifies it. So we have just discussed that project management related experience, like you are making schedule, you are identifying end stakeholders, you are involved in making scope statements, you are doing risk management, you are identifying risk, you are making quality policy for the project. So such kind of experience is relevant for PMP certification because it is all about leading and directing projects. Other criteria are that you need to acquire 35 contact hours of training. Now, 35 contact hours means you need to take a project management education program which teaches the PMBOK for 35 hours. That is the only consideration for PMI. Now, these 35 hours of training can be attained in classroom. You can enroll for a classroom program and visit. This can be also taken online. Online, there are two modes. One mode is that a session like this, where an instructor is sitting in front of you, you schedule a time and you go there. That's one mode. The another mode could be that you have a collection of videos, there is a system being built, you have an assessment and all, and you just take it as and when you want to do it. So, whichever mode you take, all are acceptable. So, you just need to acquire 35 contact hours of training. And after that, you need to pay money. So, if you are a member, you pay $405, and if you are not a member, you pay $555 to a PMI. Membership, first time membership will cost you $139. So, in total, you end up paying $550 for the exam to the PMI. So, exam is for 4 hours, and it will have 200 questions. And on the basis of your performance in exam, they will rank you as a certified or not a certified person. The PMI membership is for 1 year. In $139, you get a membership for a 1 year. You can extend it for India, like they have a special economical scheme in which you can extend it by, if you are living in India, then you can extend it by just paying $65. But that's the second time. First time you do need to buy it by paying $139. So I think there are many questions which are not yet answers related to this. I will just take them. Okay. So I am taking from Raghendra's question. So he had two questions, I guess. With IQ, I think both have both the options. I have a product which is online and I provide a such kind of continuous interaction every alternate Saturday. So I can only talk about my product. Rest you can get from VizIQ. Our product is online. You get everything as a part of the package. After that, every alternate Saturday, I conduct such sessions to clarify doubts. But the primary delivery happens through the pre-recorded content. You can check the sample videos, they are classroom videos, you will get an idea. So, second question was from Rajendra only. My PMP application has been accepted few months back, so if I am eligible, period is 1 year from approval. Next process is to make the payment and schedule the exam, right? Yes. And your eligibility period has already started. So, if you pay the fee after 3 months, don't assume that after payment the 1 year period is started. 1 year period is already started. And that is the advice I want to give to others also. Only do your application work when you want to give the exam within a month's time. Unnecessarily do not consume your 1 year period. Now this 1 year period may look just a single thing, but there are many things associated with it. This 1 year period will also help, is also applicable when you take the exam again. So don't do your application processing early. For your answer, yes, your 1 year period has started, pay that money, and after payment, PMI may select some application for audit. So audit step is not yet over, after payment only they select the application for audit. And once they are through, you will get an eligibility ID. Using that ID, you can schedule your exam. Nothing left after that. So, Prashant queries got answered. Raj, I don't have a particular project experience, but I am very much interested in it and planning to have a career in the field for my core construction field. So, what can you do? So, for example, if you don't have a project management experience and you think that you should be doing project manager in order to move forward, legally speaking, PMI has an option for you. They have another certificate which is called CAPM. So CAPM certificate is an entry level certificate where you don't need experience as a project manager. So you can consider doing that. The other thing, Raj, you can look at it, that you can look critically to your job profile, and you may find that you might be doing project activities and which are all five process groups. Like you might be partially involved in identifying stakeholders. So if you look your profile very critically, you may end up finding that there is a way to project or to think that yes, you have been working in a project management. But do connect offline, I may be able to help you to navigate that. Now, similar experience Sandeep has, similar question Sandeep has raised, that for example, I spoke about five process groups. So they are not phases, they are five process groups, like initiating, planning, monitoring and control, executing, so and closing. Now, one need to have experience in all five process groups. Now, PMI has not recommended any distribution of it. Like for example, you need a 4,500 hours, which is equivalent to 3 years experience in all these five process groups. PMI is not saying that it should be 10% in this and 20% in this, but PMI is recommending that you should have experience in all process groups. So it may vary. You may have more experience in executing. The another thing which you should remember is, it's not necessary for an each and every project you need to have experience in all five process groups. There could be a possibility that in a given project, you were only involved in executing, but in other, you were only involved in planning. But in total, you should have experience in all five process groups. Now, Ravi Shankar is asking that he has undergone 35 PDUs for PMBOK 5. Now, is it required to do it again for PMBOK version 5? The answer is no. PMI does not mandate that you should do it again. That's the legal requirement. Now, what I tell people, my program is not for 35 contact hours. It does give a 35 contact hours, but our goal is to facilitate the real certification. And there are many things which comes in between when you really start preparing for the exam. So if you need some assistance for clearing the exam, then only enroll. As a legal requirement, you don't need it. Okay, what will be fee for that? So I think you are asking a fee for our program. Our program fee is $80 or 4,000 rupees per year. So that is how the fee is. One question that I am into finance, and how do you think this can help me? See, finance is a domain. And if you are in project management or finance, this will help you. But if you are in operation, if you are managing a portfolio or a cash counter or some defined work, then a project management may not be the right. So a green belt will work for operations also. So like green belt is a continuous improvement when you analyze the data. Again, take an example of a cash counter. So how much time do we take to deliver a cash to a customer? How can we improve it? So this is a green belt kind of thing. But if you initiate a project for improving it, it falls under project. Like you have analyzed the value stream of delivering cash to a customer. Now you are proposing a separate value stream which can improve the delivery time, it becomes a project management. Another question which is equivalent to Rajendra is coming from Sandeep, like what is the validity period for training I have attended last year? As of now, PMI 35 PDUs training is valid for lifelong. So they have not put any expiry date. So as a legal requirement, you don't have to do it. If you have done it 3 years ago, still you can use it for you applying the PMP exam. So you don't worry about it. Only enroll if you get need an assistance. Don't look for 35 contact hours. Okay, so Rajendra, I think you are asking about the clarification sessions. Clarification session, we have an online forum. So Sandeep, that is the point. That in order to pass the exam, it's good if you go through a training. Now again, you need to find a training provider also well, because majority of training providers are primarily focused on stamping 35 contact hours training certificate. There are only few who focus on making you certified. So you find a training company, a provider, who focuses on getting you certified. So that is how it is different. So that is how it is. You should look at it. Now what we do, we have a forum. Now another question which is also Raghavendra has asked, that why do we do a clarification session and all. So we have a 24/7 forum. Our people, whenever they get a doubt, they post it in a forum. So we keep replying. We have a chat like within 12 hours we reply to our people. After that, we consolidate few topics and we discuss those topics at the alternate Saturday. Lot of time people who have done PMT during that week, they also join. Like in the last week, there was a person who just finished their PMT exam, his PMT exam, he joined in, he shared his experience. So we are trying to create a community where people remain engaged till the time they clear the exam. Now PMBOK get updated every 3 years. So that is the planned upgrade from PMI. Every 3 years they come up with a new version. So that was the question from Raj and I have answered it. So Sonam is asking, I think multiple times she has posted it, if I have experience of training of a project management, can I do apply for it? See, as I said, the training becomes operations once they become very streamlined. As an experience requirement, you need to have experience of managing projects. So project, you can take training as a project also. So it all depends how you are planning and how you are projecting it. So it could be yes, it all depends how you put your experience on an application. Now this is the video, we have a video on how to write PMT, experience in a PMI application. Just look for it, you will get an idea how to project your experience. And if you end up becoming our client, then we assist even we review the application and also. That's the separate thing, but even if you are not our client, you can search a video on my YouTube channel, it's like Ivan Rich. If you just go to Google to search how to fill a PMT experience, you will end up reaching to our video. Okay, so interesting question. So do I need to do a PMT again and again if I have done all PMT version 3, 4 and 5? So that's what Raj is asking, because the upgrade is happening every 3 years. The answer is no. So you don't have to give the exam again, but there is a process which is called continuous education process, in which you need to do some work, you need to do some studies and train it to PMI. There is a process of reporting PDUs to PMI, but there is no exam. So let's assure that exam is only once, because project management is not going to change so drastically version with version. I did in 2006, so it's been a while I did my PMT certification. And these are my contact details. So my email ID is saket.council@eisenbridge.com. I have a YouTube channel, youtube.com/eisenbridge. We have 50 videos on project PMP. We have nearby 100 videos in total on project management. That you can do. So I think Rajendra has asked one more question. To get a PDU, do you need to be a PMI member? How PDU is credited and validated yearly? Don't worry as of now about that. It is a process. You don't have to be a PMI member. First thing, you don't have to pay money regularly. After 3 years, you can do it. And there is a process of doing. Again, we have a detailed video on how to claim PDU easily without spending money. So if you go to our YouTube channel, you will find an easy steps to earn PDUs. But don't worry about it as of now, but they are easy and better. And if you get associated with a good training provider, he will take care of your PDUs also, the way we do. So Raj, just follow that thread, the way we are following, you will get the link for our experience thing. Exam pattern, there are 200 questions and all are multiple choice. Usually the questions are scenario based, so rather than asking that what is schedule variance, you will not get questions like this. They are not definition kind of questions. You will get questions like this, that XYZ is a project manager, he thought of an activity A should be done on 10 days, now this activity A has taken 20 days, now how should he monitor the deviation between activity A? So something like this. So you interpret, okay, this situation is pointing towards schedule variance. So that is how, and the simplifying things, but there are situational based, because the PMT exam is not the exam of understanding the terms, it is an exam of understanding the terms and applying it in a project management area. So friends, this is all I have to share, and do remain connected through our YouTube channels. You can follow me on Twitter also. We have a forum, forum.eisenbridge.com. Irrespective of you are our customer or not customer, you can still be part of it. You can still be part of it. There is an open area which supports everyone, whoever becomes want to ask questions related.